welcome back to Interpreting the Scares. Today we're bringing it back to the world of Final Destination with the third film in the series. It's Final Destination 3. Originally, this movie was actually supposed to be done in 3D. I even remember scoffing at the original poster of the film that said, Final Destination 3D. But that idea was abandoned for various reasons. One was because financial reasons. The other reason was because they didn't think that the redness of the blood would work that well for the red anaglyph part of the 3D glasses. And as we all know, that's not how 3D movies are made anymore. But they used to be made like that. And it blows my mind to think that people actually knowingly went in and paid to see movies with red and blue filters covering their eyes. It's insane. I feel like that would ruin the experience, but meh. No, this film was made in 2D like its forebears. End of story. Let's get cracking. This review is brought to you by the word of the day, forebear, precursor. Final Destination 3 takes a new group of individuals escaping death when young Wendy has a premonition that the roller coaster that she and her friends are riding will have a massive accident. It'll derail, mechanisms will falter, leaving everybody dying grisly deaths. She's able to get most everybody off the coaster, but soon thereafter, death returns for their souls, one by one. Can she find a new way to escape death? While I like this movie, it's definitely the first film in the series to feel like a cheap, money-grabbing sequel. It's hard to effectively call it a real sequel when nobody returns for a cameo, not even Death himself, played by Tony Todd. Now, he does a voice cameo, but if that's not calling it in, I don't know what is. But I did say that as a general rule, I had a good time with this movie, and I did. Here's why. As with any good horror film sequel, it changes things up just enough to contain its own identity. In Final Destination 3, the thing that stands out as unique this time around is deciphering how these people are going to die. Death's design is something that often changes with all these movies, and instead of trying to figure out who's next, which is what the previous films did, this film went the other way around, and it tried to figure out how the next person will die. How do they decide to do this? Through the use of paranormal photography, which is a first for the series. Before these people ride the roller coaster of death, they take a picture of everybody at the amusement park, and the last image they took before their demise gives a slight hint at how they would die in real life when death eventually comes back for them. They made an example of this in the film where they show the last picture Abraham Lincoln took before his death, and in the picture there's this abnormality in the photo where there's a crease line or a crack that runs through it in the exact trajectory a bullet would have taken by John Wilkes Booth. That's actually a real thing, that's a real photograph of Abraham Lincoln. So that's the idea behind Final Destination 3, and it's something that I really found to be compelling as these main characters are following the clues they found in these photos to hopefully escape death. In general, I like the idea of paranormal photography since I haven't really seen many examples of it in film, so its usage in this movie is pretty cool. That being said, it's hard not to notice that the paranormal photography part of the movie also serves as its own negative, because one of the most compelling and mysterious challenges of the first two movies was the fact that they didn't know how everybody would die, and because they didn't know, the film was able to really showcase red herrings and prove to the audience that we live in a world surrounded by things that can kill us if we make one small mistake. So every few minutes in those movies, things are happening left and right that make us wonder if it'll end up killing one of the main characters, hence a red herring. Maybe it will, maybe it won't. But in Final Destination 3, because you already have a good idea of what will happen next and how these people will die, it's unable to secure a good red herring. You won't be second-guessing yourself, and everything now becomes super predictable. It also limits death in its ability to kill you. The people in the first film went from location to location to location, and everywhere they went, there was always all these different things that could happen to them that could naturally kill them. Not so here. These people have to be in a specific spot at a specific time in order for death to kill them, making this feel much less organic and realistic. Finally, I gotta say, the chain reactions in general for this movie are kind of weak, as are the visuals, especially at the very beginning of the movie. If I'm also going to be uber honest with you, a plane accident as seen in the first film and a traffic accident as seen in the second movie hold much more weight than a roller coaster that crashes. Does that kind of thing happen in real life? I mean, sure, sometimes, but you don't really hear about it that much because it's usually nothing insanely tragic. Also, someone has to bring it up, but they figured out how to defeat death in the second movie. Completely. So one, why aren't there cameos in this movie? And two, if these people can research the events of the other films and figure out that the survivors died in freak accidents, then surely their research should be able to tell them how to defeat the curse. Yet it's conveniently ignored for this movie to happen. And that's what annoys me the most about this movie. Is the accidents the people go through in this movie cool and interesting? Yeah, sure, sometimes, but it's probably one of the more forgettable films in the entire series. Let's go ahead and break down my final score for a second. From an unbiased technical level, I gotta say they dropped the ball quite a bit here, and in general, it definitely feels less cinematic than the others. It's not completely garbage from a technical level, but there were a ton of areas that could have easily been approached better. That unbiased score is 58%. My bias score is still somewhat higher because it's a guilty pleasure series through and through, and that's why my bias score is still relatively high at 88%, averaging everything out to a final rating of 73%, 73 out of 100 possible stars, or a C letter grade. When it comes down to Final Destination, Nation 3, all of my scores are lower than the other films in the series because even though it's, you know, still a fun movie overall, it's not as fun as the others, and obviously the technical score was pretty low in general, but thankfully, that's not really why you watch any of these movies. You watch them to have a good time, and I think for the most part, you still have a good time while watching this third one. But guys, tell me your thoughts on Final Destination 3 in the comment section down below. As far as the series go, do you think that they should have stayed with the original cast, or do you think that this new cast was a lot of fun? I, for one, really like Mary Elizabeth Winstead in pretty much anything that she ever does. But what about you? Let me know. As for YouTube, you guys know what to do. Hit the thumbs up button if you enjoyed this review, because there's always more like it coming out each and every single day. Hit the subscribe button and bell to be notified when I come out with my review for the fourth Final Destination movie. And until then, peace out.
Dave examines movies. We just watch for fun. Davey is the expert. He is the number one critic that I go to when I need a movie pick. Thanks for joining up with us.